outside and think I got here on my own. But there's no way that you could ever know how much grace and mercy I've been shown. Oh, if you look into my eyes, you see life has tried to get the best of me. I know the giver of life personally. He's the reason that I sing. His name is Jesus, and he loves me. And I know this, 'cause he died for me and he rescued me. There's no greater love in the world. His name is Jesus. Yes, he loves me, and I know this, 'cause he said it to me when he rescued me. There's no great love in the world. Oh, 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 oh. There's so many things I wanna tell you of how he made a way for me. If he hadn't loved me.
Well, good morning to First Baptist. It's good to see so many wonderful faces. I'm glad to see you all. Today, we're going to begin our devotion part of the service, and with anticipation that our pastor will come out and he will just explode with what God has in store for us today. I'm glad to see everybody today. I'd like for us to sing just a verse of My Hope is Built on Nothing Less. We'll sing the first and the fourth verse, and then we'll move from there.
My hope is built on nothing less than my hope. My hope is built on nothing less.
Thank you. Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. And then the fourth verse. When he shall come with trumpet sound, oh, may I then in him be found, dressed in his righteousness alone, faultless to stand before the throne. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so very much for who you are in our lives. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for being Lord. We thank you for being our Savior. We thank you for being our helper. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for being our guider and our counselor. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for being one who never goes back on his promises. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for creating all that you have. And Lord, we just pray that you would just help us to continue to appreciate the things that you have done. And for some of us who don't appreciate what you've done for us, oh Lord, we pray that you would touch their hearts, oh God, and help them to see if it wasn't for you, they would be in a worse situation than they are today. And so, Father, we just thank you. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for making sure the church doors were open and not padlocked shut. We thank you, dear Heavenly Father, for your good people who've come out this morning to worship you, Heavenly Father. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for allowing our pastor to come before us Sunday after Sunday to bring your word to us. And, Father, we pray that we would act upon your word. We pray, Lord, that they would just not be blowing in the wind, but the words would sink into our hearts that we might not sin against you. And so today, Lord, we ask you to be in the midst of us. We ask you, Lord, to bless those who are here. Bless those on their way, Heavenly Father, and bless those who are listening to us on some social media platform. We thank you for them. And Heavenly Father, we pray that what we do today would bring you glory and honor. We pray, dear Lord, that you would just touch, guide, and keep us. We pray for the elderly, Lord. We pray, Heavenly Father, for the young people. We pray especially for ourselves, oh God, because we need to hear from you. We need a blessing from you. And Heavenly Father, we need to continue to be reassured that you are there for us. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for all you've done and will do for us. In Jesus' name, amen. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. All in my church, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, all in my church, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. All in my church, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. All in my home, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, all in my home, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. All in my home, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. All before my enemies, I'm gonna let it shine, Lord. All before my enemies, I'm gonna let it shine. All before my enemies, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. I'm gonna let it shine, 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 gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, Lord, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Amen. Let's do that. Let's do that everywhere we go. It can be tough, but let's do it anyway. I'd like to read some scripture, and maybe you've heard this before. And if you have, good, then you can memorize it and share with us. But if you can't, if you would open your Bibles to the book of Philippians, chapter 4. Just like to read a few verses of Philippians, chapter 4. And I'm going to start with verse number 4. So if you have your, like I said, your Bibles, or you have good memories, yep, then that's good. You probably don't need Prevagen. But the God is good. Uh-oh, some of us do take it. That's good. Whatever it takes. All right. Philippians 4, verse 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Let your gentleness be known to all men. The Lord is at hand. Be anxious for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. And then, verse 8, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are noble, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there is any virtue And if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. The things which you've learned and received and heard and saw in me, these do, and the God of peace will be with you. Some words that Apostle Paul had written from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 9. Somebody has a song out there they want us to sing. What song did you want us to sing today? Oh, whoa, nobody. Okay, well, I found a song until you get ready to give us your song. Lift him up. Did somebody say they have a song? Raise your hand so I'll see. Nobody. Oh, yes, Sister Perry. Go ahead. Tell them what you want. Whoa. Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Oh, Jesus on the main line now. Yeah. Tell him what you want. Oh, call him up. Call him up and tell him what you want. Call him up. Call him up and tell him what you want. Oh, Jesus on the main line now. Tell him what you want. Oh, if you're sick and can't get well, tell him what you want. If you're sick and can't get well, tell him what you want. Oh, Jesus on the main line now. Call main line. Tell him what you want. Oh, main line. Main line. Tell him what you want. Main line, main line. Tell him what you want. Oh, Jesus on the main line now. Amen. There's a promise. Jesus on the main line. Tell him what you want. Thank you, Sister Perry. And thank you all for participating in the devotion today. Hopefully you did participate. And if you didn't, well, maybe next week we'll sing a song that you want us to sing. And we'll read a scripture that you want us to read. But right now, we'll make do with what we have. So we're going to decrease at this point, and we'll ask the representative of the pulpit to increase. Thank you. Thank you. Make it a great day. God bless you.
We will have our invocation. Heavenly Father, we love you on today. We bless you on today. Father, we want to worship you in spirit and in truth. We ask, Father, we beseech, we beg that you would come into this place, come into this sanctuary, come into our hearts, and that you would inspect us. Father, we present ourselves to you for your inspection, for you to scrutinize us. If there is anything in us, Father, that is not right, that is not righteous, that is not holy, we repent of our sins right here and right now so that nothing can hinder us from sweet fellowship with you. Father, we pray that you would inhabit the praises of us, your people. We pray that you would get a good look and say, you know, let me come down and spend some time with these folk because they love me. We want to demonstrate our love to you, demonstrate our obedience, demonstrate our dependence. Father, we love you and we thank you for your Son, Christ Jesus. We thank you for the indwelling presence of your Holy Spirit. Be pleased in our worship. Let us be good and faithful servants, good and faithful children, good and faithful citizens in the kingdom of God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let us recite the 100th Psalm. And it says, make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, he is God. It is he that hath made us and not we ourselves. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Be thankful unto him and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Amen. The mission and vision statement. Let us read it together. To introduce, present to all people, Jesus Christ through our empowering ministries, by equipping the membership through the effective teaching and preaching of the word to the glory of God. Amen. I believe we have a song, a selection by, as Sister Bull says, by our Rat Now Choir. Amen.
Thank you.
We will now have scripture by Elder Bell.
Good morning, family. All of my cousins. How are you this hot morning? Glad to be here, though. Amen. Our sermon scripture this morning is coming from Genesis chapter 32. Genesis chapter 32. And I'll be reading from verses 22 to 29. You have it, say amen. Amen. And it reads as thus. Now he arose that same night and took his two wives and his two maids and his 11 children and crossed the ford of the Jabbok. He took them and sent them across the stream, and he sent across whatever he had. Then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. When he saw that he had not prevailed against him, he touched the socket of his thigh, so the socket of Jacob's thigh was dislocated while he wrestled with him. Glory, glory, glory. Then he said, "Let me go, for the dawn is breaking." But he said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." So he said to him, "What is your name?" And he said, "Jacob." He said, "Your name shall no longer be Jacob, but Israel, for you have striven with God and with men and have prevailed." Then Jacob asked him and said, "Please tell me your name." And he said, "Why is it that you ask my name?" And he blessed him there. Amen.
Congregation, won't you join me this morning in lifting up the hymn? There are some things I may not know. There are some places I cannot go. But I am sure of this one thing, that God is real, for I can feel him deep within. Oh yes, God is, yes, God is real. He's real in my soul, real in my soul. Oh yes, God is real. For he has washed and made me whole. His love for me is just like pure gold. Oh yes, God is real, for I can feel him in my soul. Some folk may doubt, and some folk may scorn. All can desert and leave me alone. But as for me, I'll take God's part, for God is real, and I can feel him in my heart. Oh, yes, God, yes, God is real. He's real in my, real in my soul. Oh, yes, God is real, for he has washed and made me whole. for His love for me is just like pure gold. Oh yes, God is real, for I can feel Him in my soul. I cannot tell just how you felt when Jesus took your sins away. But since that day, but since that hour, God has been real, for I can feel His holy power. Oh, yes, God is real. He's real in my soul. Oh, yes, God is real, for He has washed and made me whole. Just like your gold. Oh yes, God is real, for I can feel Him in my soul. Oh yes, God is real. He's real in my soul. Oh yes, God is real. For He has washed and made me whole. Oh, His love for me is just like pure gold. Yes, God is real, for I can feel Him in my soul. Hark, the herald angels did sing, Jesus the light of the world. Oh, and glory to the newborn King. Oh, Jesus the light of the world. Oh, now let us walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, and shine all around us by day and by night. Oh, Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, joyful all ye nations rise. Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, and join the triumph of the skies. Oh, Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, now let us walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, and shine all around us by day and by night. Oh, Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, Christ, by highest heaven adored. Jesus, the light of the world. Christ, the everlasting Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, now let us walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, and shine all around. by day and by night. Oh, Jesus, the light of the world. Hail the heaven-born Prince of Peace. Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, and hail the Son of Righteousness. Oh, Jesus, the light of the world. Oh, now let us walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, and shine all around us by day and by night. Oh, Jesus, the light.
First Baptist, can heaven hear you? No music, no. Come on, lift your voice.
Walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, and shine all around us by day and by night. Oh, Jesus.
I don't think the angels in heaven heard you. Can you sing it one more time?
Now let us walk in the light. Oh, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, and shine all around us by day and by night. Oh, Jesus, the light of...
Y'all sound good. Can... All the way in the back.
Now let us walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, and shine all around.
First Baptist, can we sing it one more time? One more time so that Second Avenue can hear us.
The light of the... Oh, now let us walk in the light, beautiful, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, and shine all around us by day and by night. Oh, Jesus, the light of the... Now let us walk in the light, beautiful light. Come where the dewdrops of mercy shine bright. Oh, and shine all around us by day and by night. Oh, Jesus, the light of the world.
Oh, come on, if you know that Jesus is the light of the world, come on and lift up your hands, lift up your head, open up your mouth, and give God some praise. Our God is worthy of all of our praise. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Oh, bless the Lord. Oh, my soul and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Hallelujah! Hallelujah! Yes. God, we thank you. God, we bless you. God, we praise your name today because you are an awesome God and you are truly worthy to be praised. Thank you, Lord God, for down sitting last night in our early morning rise. Thank you, God, for the use and activities of our limbs. Thank you, God, that in spite of, we are yet alive. In spite of, we still have the use and activities of our limbs. In spite of, we can still put our glad hands together. In spite of, we can still look to the hill from which cometh our help. In spite of, God, all that we've been through, all that we're going through, and all that we have yet to go through, we still have a praise in our heart. We still have a song on our lips. We still have dancing in our feet because you're the same God yesterday, today, and forevermore.
Hallelujah.
And so God, we give you all the glory, all of the honor, and all of the praise. We thank you and we bless your name this morning. By whole hearts, we say hallelujah, hallelujah, and hallelujah. It is good to be back home. I missed y'all last Sunday. I was really missing you until a whole group of y'all walked in the First Baptist Church of Deer Park and made me feel right at home. Amen. I want to thank all of you who worked so diligently and so hard on last weekend. Amen. To make the celebration and installation for our friend, our brother, Pastor Deshaun Burrell, a wonderful event. Amen. I know it took a lot of work. It was hot, but you persevered. Amen. You were here early and you stayed late. And we want to thank, I have to use Sister Bull's term here. We thank the A team, the B team, the C team, and the D team. Amen. All the teams were out last week and working. Amen. 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 You made First Baptist look good. Very good. And we thank you for your commitment. We pray that you are making it in this heat. My wife and I have a show that we love to watch, Forged in Fire. Amen. And some of you may be familiar with it, but if you watch it, it takes heat to make a good knife. Amen, somebody. It takes heat to make us strong. Amen. And so we need to forge ahead in the heat. Amen. Y'all preachers don't write that down. That's an acronym for faith. Forge ahead in the heat. I see y'all making notes over there. Amen. Xavier preaching away next week. We can't hear him. So, amen. This morning, I don't want to hold you long because it's supposed to be the hottest day of the year. Amen. So far, we're going to break some records, and I hope y'all find a place that's nice and cool. Get you a nice cool glass of lemonade or iced tea. and enjoy what God has blessed us with. I've come to understand, if you complain about the heat, Sister Lane, it'll only get hotter. Because it's a mental thing, amen? But just understand that there is another place that's hotter than this. Amen. And at least we can find some relief with the air conditioner or the fan or a nice cool breeze. But according to the Bible, you get no relief in that place. Amen? Amen. I want to invite your attention this morning back to the book of Genesis, a scripture lesson that was read in your hearing. Elder Bell, thank you so much for reading our scripture. And then I want to direct your attention, realistically, if you get a chance, those of you who are, I did not give you a summer reading assignment this summer, amen, but if you really want to get the gist of this whole story, go all the way back to chapter 26 of Genesis and read up until this point, and you will get the full story of Jacob and his family and how we arrive at verse 29. I love verse 29. It says, "Then Jacob asked him and said, 'Please tell me your name.' But he said, 'Why is it that you ask my name?' And then he didn't answer, but he concluded with this, 'And he blessed him there.'" And he blessed him there. I want to talk this morning briefly from the subject, blessed in the battle. Blessed in the battle. I want to go out on a limb here, and I want to say and suggest that there's not a person here this morning that haven't had some type of battle, some type of struggle, some type of tension that you've had to experience in your life. And I know some of you saying, "Well, Pastor, we got some little babies in here. They ain't had no struggles. They ain't had no battles." Well, if they were born, they had a struggle. Better can struggle from conception to birth to stay alive and struggle to make it. So the statement remains true. that I believe that everyone here has had some type of struggle or test or trial in your life. And I wonder if you've been like me and you've asked yourself the question that while you were in that battle or that struggle, what good is going to come out of this? Elder Xavier asked me a question after he finished reading the scripture. He sat down and he said to me, right before he got up, he said, "Where's the blessing?" And I texted him while he was reading scripture. I texted him the answer. I didn't want to tell him. I texted it to him so he could get it. But we ask these questions when we're going through trials and tribulations and tragedies in our lives. We look up to God and we say, "God, why? Why are we going through this?" And you're in good company because Job asked the same question. Job followed that question up with some subsequent questions, intense questions to God. But they all boil down, Sister Jones, to the same thing. Why am I going through what I'm going through? Has anybody asked that question? Have you asked that question? Let's be honest. Yes, I've asked that question. Yes, I have asked that question not once, not twice, but a few times in my journey. God, what is the blessing or what is the benefit of this? Well, I'm glad that you asked that question. I got a message that's going to help you today because I need you to know that everything that you go through, that God allows you to go through, there is a blessing in it. Ah, hello, somebody. There's a blessing in it. You may not see it while you were in the blessing, while you were in the battle, but Sister Green, we may not even see it when we come out. It may be down the road while we're dealing with something else that we look back and we realize that the previous battle prepared me for the battle that I'm going through right now. Oh, I wish I had some help in here. When you look not only at the Bible, but more specifically this morning at the lives of Jacob, you will see that his entire life was a battle. That even in the womb, he was at war with his twin brother, Esau. They struggled with each other in the womb. I'm going to use this word struggle and battle interchangeably today, but the words simply mean the same. You are struggle. You are at war. You are at odds with something, somebody, or yourself. And sometimes you could be in struggle or battle with all three of them at the same time. Oh, I wish I had some help this morning. From inception, here Jacob is struggling with his brother. This is not the first time that we see biblically where brothers have struggled with each other. We can go all the way back to the beginning of this book. The first two boys that arrived on the planet struggled and battled with each other, and one killed the other one. Y'all know the story. So we revisit this family feud, if you will, in the womb of the offspring of Abraham. Abraham's promised son, Isaac, goes through a number of situations, but he's now married, and now his wife has conceived, and she brings forth Jacob and Esau, these twin brothers who come out fighting with each other from the beginning. And as they grow up and as they develop, one steals the birthright of the other. They just continue to struggle, continue to battle, continue to be at war with one another. And Jacob, even though after this great struggle, he steals his brother's birthright, he then leaves home, or he is forcibly pushed out of his house, and he goes out. He's sent away by his dad, and you know that's hard to be able to do tough love, send your son away. But he goes out, and he even struggles out there. Sometimes we leave places because things ain't going the way we wanted to, and we're struggling and we're battling where we are, and we leave that job to go to another one to only find out there's another battle over there. And in some situations, it's worse over there than where we left. I wish I had some help. Not only do it with jobs, we do it with churches, we do it with communities. If the community ain't right, we move to another one, only to find out there's some other issues and some problems. We are constantly faced with struggles and troubles. I told somebody yesterday, because it's so hot, I'm not going to preach too hard this morning. And they said to me, well, that's up to God. So we're going to leave it to God because it's feeling real good to me right now. As we try to escape these struggles and troubles that are produced by other folk, I've come to find out that if we really look at the thing, there's a common denominator in all of the troubles and struggles that we experience. And that common denominator is me. I'm just talking about myself, but, you know, it's you. If you're in the issue and you keep having the issue and you keep blaming the issue on somebody else, maybe you need to turn the mirror around and begin to do some self-examination. See, all of the problems that Jacob is running into away from home is because of himself. Jacob is struggling. Jacob is battling one time and another time and over with this person, with that person. And his name, Jacob, meant, or is translated in the Hebrew, supplanter or trickster. And he winds up falling victim to tricks himself. Hello, somebody. I want y'all to read all that because I can't go into all that because I really got to get in the battle. Because Jacob is here in a battle. And Jacob is in a battle in three aspects. First of all, Jacob is fighting or was fighting with his brother Esau. And he tricked him. He stole his birthright. He did all of that. Then had to flee. Then he was scared of his brother because he knew his brother was coming after him. I wish I had some help in here. That's an ongoing battle. It is a thread that is running constantly through this story. And I've come to understand something in reading this story, that if you don't get the foundation of the problem settled, you're going to always have a problem or an issue. And this, his Esau problem was with him throughout his sojourn. And it wasn't until by the grace of God and the blessing of God that Esau, or that Jacob came to himself and said, I got to get this thing right with Esau. Nothing turns out right until he gets to that place. And so there's this battle, this ongoing battle with his brother Esau. There is an ongoing battle with himself. That's a big one. Jacob is fighting with himself. And in this age, Sister Green, of mental health issues, a lot of us won't admit that we are battling with ourselves. Listen, y'all. We all have some history. We all have some skeletons, and they ain't all dried up, they ain't all disfigured, they ain't all laying around there where some of our skeletons have flesh and sinew and muscle and walking around talking. Hello, somebody. And until we deal with us, ourselves, we're not going to be able to escape these battles that are happening in our lives. Some of us have had such bad experiences from other people that we expect to be treated by others based on our past. I went through a period in my life where some things were out there about me, and I was walking around, and it seemed like everybody that I looked at, Sister Gwen, knew my problem, knew my issue. And I thought that they were looking at me. I thought they were judging me just by looking at me. And I had somebody tell me in a nice way, you know, everybody can't read. Everybody ain't listening to what's out there. You can't just group everybody in one category and say, these people are going to treat me the way that I've always been treated. Yes, you've had some people that mistreat you and abuse you in your life. And listen, I don't mean don't go out here blindly running, acting crazy. Guard yourself, but don't prejudge people and then take away their opportunity to be a blessing to you. See, if we haven't dealt with our internal issues and our internal problems and our past issues, it's going to be hard for us to step into a new situation because we're imprisoned by our past. My God. Yeah. But I've come to set you free. Because who the Son has set free is free indeed. Jacob is wrestling and battling with his brother Esau. He's wrestling and he's struggling with himself. But y'all, he is also struggling and wrestling with God. Ah, this is the big one. Because here's how we struggle and wrestle with God. When we question why God allows things and situations to come our way. Why does God allow sickness and terminal diseases to show up in our lives? Why does God allow us to be laid off and fired and transferred? Why does God allow us to experience heartache and pain in our lives? I've come to understand in reading this Bible and walking with the Lord that everything God brings us to, God has the power to take us through it. That's why David, hallelujah, somebody's going to get it. Listen, if you just understand it this morning, that whatever you're going through, the God that brought you to this is more than God enough to take you through it. I dare you to declare this morning, I'm going through. I'm going through. Watch this. Lonnie Quinn says it's going to be a heat wave up until Monday. He said, I guarantee you there's going to be a heat wave up until Monday. But Tuesday, there's going to be a possible break in the way. I wish I had some help in here. Listen, if you could just grab this morning, there is a possible break in your situation just on the horizon. You might have to go through a couple of more days to get there, but I dare you to hold on. I dare you to trust in God. Your breakthrough is coming. Your breakthrough is coming. But you've got to go through it to get to your breakthrough. Listen, the songwriter said, if I never had a problem, I would not know that God could solve them. Come on, if I was never hungry, I wouldn't know God could feed me. If I was never thirsty, I wouldn't know that God could provide me some water. I wish I had some witnesses in here. If I was never sick, I wouldn't know that the power of God could heal me. You've got some testimonies right here in the sanctuary, right there in your home, right there in your living room. Just look around. You got a roof over your head, clothes on your back. You may not have a whole lot of food in the refrigerator, but there's some victuals in the refrigerator. You got a little buggy out in front. Hello, somebody. God has been good. Yes. Been good. Oh, hallelujah. God's been good. But watch this. God's been good even in your battle. Yeah. So, Mother Reed, we've been in a battle as a people for years. And let me give you a news alert. We're going to continue to be in the battle as long as we're down here on this earth. I heard something the other day. The World Health Organization has made the determination that COVID is going to be around for a long time. Now, y'all been sitting here. We go back a couple of months. Somebody can remember when Pastor Clark stood right behind this desk and declared that COVID wasn't going nowhere. I said it's going to be around. I'm glad that they agreed with me. I ain't on the committee. I just got a little sense. And just looked like to me that if the 100-year Spanish flu is still around, y'all, we're going to be dealing with COVID for a long time. But I need you to understand that if you're trusting God, that even in the battle, God will, God can bless you. See, that's the message this morning, that in the battle, there is a blessing. In the battle, in the struggle, there is a blessing. Jacob, in his deliverance from himself, wrestles with God. This pericope starts off with Jacob sending his family and his possessions across the river, and he is left alone. And at night there appeared unto him, some translations say an angel, some say it was a man. The reality of it is that Jacob was wrestling with something. He wasn't just wrestling with himself, he was wrestling with a being. That's right. And I believe it was a spiritual being. You can call it an angel, but it was a blessing unto him because he was in the battle. And watch this. Here's where I get excited. Here he is wrestling with God, or wrestling with the representative of God. And if you read the text correctly, Elder Bruce, he was winning. See, y'all was supposed to shout right there. Y'all was supposed to shout right there. Said verse 24, and then Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until the break of day. And when he, the angel, saw that he had not prevailed against him, that means Jacob was winning. And because Jacob was winning, this angel, this man, this being, dislocated Jacob's hip. He said, listen, I can't win with this man, so let me give myself an advantage. Let me dislocate his hip. Y'all, this is the text. I ain't making it up. He was winning against the angel, and the angel says, I got to limit his ability so I can win. Oh, I wish I had some help in here. He dislocated his hip. Watch this. He dislocated his hip, giving the angel or the man the advantage over Jacob. But Jacob wouldn't let him go. Hallelujah. Watch this. The enemy would try to disable you, Sister Green, in the midst of your situation. But I dare you to hold on. Listen, don't give up. Just hold on. Maybe you have limited my ability to fight. Maybe you've shifted the percentages in your favor, but I ain't gonna let go, because I understand that there is a reason for this battle, and I'm not gonna let you go until I get what is designed for me. Hello, somebody. He wouldn't let him go. He wouldn't let him go. He held on to it. And he says, I'm not gonna let you go until you bless me. I wish that there was just a couple of people in here this morning that can say, I ain't gonna let God go until God blesses me. Hello, somebody. I'm not gonna let you go. Because if I let God go in the midst of the battle, there is a greater percentage of me losing the battle without God. I'd rather go through the battle handicapped with God than to go through the battle in full strength without God. Moses, can you help me? Can you help me? Moses said, I was up on the mountaintop, and Joshua was down in the valley fighting. And as I was observing the battle, I noticed that there was a connection between Joshua's ability to win and the position of my staff. Oh, I wish I had some help in here. Listen, y'all, the positioning of God in your battle will determine whether you win or lose. Make sure that you are winning. You might wane in the battle. That means you have lost focus on God. But if you look to the hill from which cometh all of your help, y'all, there's a shift coming. It may look like, it may feel like odds are against you. It may look like that you are losing, but if you got God on your side, hallelujah, you may be down, but you ain't out. Hello, somebody. You may be weak, but you ain't finished, because God is not finished with us. It might be hot, but God gives us comfort in the middle of the battle. Where is the battle? The battle with Jacob and Esau, the battle with Jacob and himself, the battle with Jacob and God. But y'all, then there's a blessing. There's a blessing in the battle. The blessing in the battle. First of all, Jacob reconciles with his brother. Don't you know God makes everything right? If you give God some time, he will work it out. Sometimes we just need to take a step back and let God work some things out. Oh, well, he ain't never going to apologize to me. Oh, well, have you thought about apologizing to him? Hello, somebody. See, the breakthrough, the way to your breakthrough starts with you. I heard a statement a long time ago, and it was made to me. You need to just get over yourself.
Some of y'all heard that statement before. You just need to get over yourself. Jacob had to get over himself. Yes, he had done some things. Yes, he was a trickster. Yes, he was a grabber. But the steps to reconciliation and change and blessings came when he got over himself. He said, listen, I can't live this way. God is blessing me with cattle and land and abundance and wives and children. I've got to get things right with my brother. I wish I had some help in here. If you know, you can be at a place of prospering and not be happy. Amen. You can have possessions and money and not be happy. There's some rich folk. Y'all read the tabloids. Y'all see it out there. They got one problem after another. They got problems that writing a check won't eliminate. Hello, somebody. Because you can't get away from yourself. I don't care how big your mansion is and how many rooms you got in it to escape. You cannot escape from yourself. And at some point, you're going to have to deal with yourself. I wondered why our foreparents were so happy with nothing. Because they were happy with themselves. I wish I had some help. When you've done everything that you can do, when you have trusted God when you didn't have, you can go to sleep at night because you know you didn't talk about nobody, you didn't mistreat nobody, you didn't deceive nobody, you didn't try to upset somebody's life, you didn't throw no rock and hide your hand, you didn't stab somebody in the back. You can go to sleep at night because you know you've done everything that God has told you to do. Once you've got peace with yourself, you can have peace with your possessions. Jacob said, I've got to go get it right with my brother. And watch this. Everything starts to turn around when he turns around and says, I'm going back to Canaan. I'm going back to Canaan. And if read the text, Elder Goodwin, that every step he took on his way back to see his brother was filled with fear. Because he knew his brother was going to kill him. Because he knew his brother was filled with vengeance and rage because of what he did. So what did he do? He put all his possessions up front. Now somebody would say, well, that's selfish. Why he wanted to kill all of his possessions? Another preacher spin it this way. Well, if he was going to die, then everything that he had should die too and let him be the last one. No. He put all his possessions up front as an offering to his brother. He literally says, everything I have, you can have it. Before you decide to kill me, everything that you've seen, all of the cattle that you've passed, all of the servants that you've passed, you can have it all if you just forgive me. And just like that prodigal son who said to himself, I'll go back home and be one of my father's hired servants. Because I no longer determined or even recognized that I should be recognized as his son. And when he got there, he got just the opposite. He got the opposite because of his mentality and because of his state when he turned around. When Jacob turned himself around and began to make his way back to his homeland to deal with his brother, he had already dealt with himself. And on his journey to deal with his brother, he encounters God in the person of this angel, and they struggle. And so he reconciles with his brother. He overcomes his past issue and his past nature, his trickster, his supplanter, his grabber mentality and nature. He succumbed to the name that was ascribed to him. But watch this. In his struggle with God, there had already been a nature change. And because there was a nature change, Sister Green, there had to be a name change. Oh my God. Sister Jones, I'm running now. I'm running now. When the angel wouldn't let him go, or when Jacob wouldn't let the angel go, he said to the angel, what is your name? He says, it don't matter what my name is. What is your name? He says, my name is trickster. My name is grabber. My name is Surplanter. And the angel said to him, no longer will your name be called Jacob. From now on, your name shall be called Israel.
Oh, somebody gonna shout in here. When you understand that the name Israel means one who struggles with God, watch this, Xavier, and prevails. See, the blessing is in the battle, is that the battle doesn't take you out. Listen, some of you have been in it, but it ain't took you out yet. And because you were in the battle, Sister Boy, and you prevailed, now you've got a new name. Your name is now Israel. Your name is now one who struggled but overcome. We've got some cancer survivors right here in the sanctuary this morning. I dare you to stand up and tell God, thank you, because you didn't overcome by yourself. There's some other folk in here that have struggled with some terminal diseases and terminal situations, but you made it through the battle because God was with you. I wish there were some testimonies in here this morning of people who have striven, who have struggled, who have battled with situation and circumstances in your life, marriages and children and jobs and community, but you've made it. I wish there was five overcomers in here this morning that can stand up and declare, I made it through the storm. I made it through the rain. I've come through some trials and some tribulation. I struggled through good times. I struggled through bad times. But through it all, I learned how to trust and depend on God. Deacon Billings, you made it. Deacon Carnigans, you made it. Deacon Jones, you made it. Other people are making it. And because you made it, you can give somebody else a high five and tell them, girlfriend, boyfriend, brother, or sister, I made it. Know that you can make it with God all things. I said with God all things are possible. Beloved, there is a blessing in the battle, and the blessing is you battle, you're battling, and you're overcoming.
I'm going home to
Amen, amen, amen. May we stand. Now we open the doors of the church. We invite you to receive Christ Jesus. If you do not know him personally in the pardoning of your sins, if there is anyone who has heard the word, who has come to the valley of decision, Scripture says, how long will you halt between two opinions? If you want to be in right relationship with God, you must accept his son, Christ Jesus, accept the perfect work that he has performed on your behalf. He came, he lived, he died, and he rose again for you. All you have to do is accept that. Say, Lord Jesus, I accept you. I believe. I repent of my sin. Romans 10:9-10. So we open the doors of the church that you would have, or that you would receive, soul salvation. Is there one? Is there one? If you have accepted Christ Jesus and you're just looking for a church home, we urge you to consider us. This is a fertile vineyard. The grapes are growing. They are ready to be plucked. They look good to the eye. We are able to nourish. Consider First Baptist Church of Bay Shore. Is there one? Well, amen. If we are all saved, and we know it, as Elder Edmund says, let us say amen.
Amen.
Amen. We will now have the altar prayer.
The hymnologist wrote, I must tell Jesus all of my trials, for I cannot bear these burdens alone. In my distresses, he kindly will help me. He ever loves and cares for his own. I must tell Jesus all of my troubles. He is a kind and compassionate friend. If I but ask him, he will deliver, make my troubles quickly an end. Tempted and tried, I need a great Savior, one who can help my burdens to bear. I must tell Jesus, I must tell Jesus, he all my cares and sorrows will share. Oh, how the world to evil allures me. Oh, how my heart is tempted to sin. I must tell Jesus and he will help me over the world, the victory to win. And then that great refrain of the church says, I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. For I cannot bear these burdens alone. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me, and Jesus alone. Father, we once again come before your throne of grace to obtain strength and to obtain mercy. God, we come bringing our problems and our situations and our burdens before you. Because in the words of those old saints of the church, says you're a burden bearer and you're a heavy load sharer. That, Lord, we'll know you come, we know you're able to come through just in the nick of time. So, God, we lay these burdens down at your feet. Because like the woman with the issue of blood, we tried everything else. But now we see that you're coming, that you've already come to town, and we're going to try you, Jesus. Should have tried you first, but God, now you've given us a chance to try you again. So, Lord, we've seen you work before, And now, God, we know that you're able to do it again. So, Father God, we thank you for healing before. But, God, we thank you that you're yet still able to heal again. God, we thank you for providing before. But, God, we thank you that you're yet still providing again. God, thank you for ways made before. But, God, thank you that you're making a way yet still again. God, thank you for banishing darkness before. But thank you for shining your light right now and banishing it away again. God, thank you for doing it again. Thank you for waking away again. Thank you for holding us again. Thank you for wiping tears away again. God, thank you for calming our fears again. God, thank you. Oh, God, for just doing it again. So, God, we come before your throne of grace, God, asking you to just do it again. Heal again, deliver again, provide again, God. Make a way again, God. Show up again, oh, God. Yeah. Father, we lay before your feet those that are sick, shut in, and recovering this morning, God. God, we know that healing shall be their portion. So, God, we pray that you would slip your nail-scarred hand in the place that they need to be healed, God. And won't you heal it, God? God, we believe, oh God, and stand on the report that cancer will dry up. God, we believe and stand on the report that high blood pressure will come down. God, we stand on the report that diabetes will be regulated. God, we stand on the report that minds will be regulated and broken hearts will put back together. God, we stand on the report that you're a healer. So God, we thank you that you're Jehovah Ropa, the great healer that resides in the sky. God, we thank you, oh God, for being with those that are going through bereavement this morning, God. God, you said you'd never leave us nor forsake us. You said you'd be with us until the ends of the earth, God. You say, there, Lord, we walk through the valleys of the shadow of death, we will be able to fear no evil, for thou art with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort us. And God, it says later, surely goodness and mercy. God, we thank you for being with those that need strength and need help right now, God. Lord, all of us are standing in need of something this morning, God. I don't know what it is, and I could call out my own stuff, but God, you know what's on my heart this morning. You know what's on all of our hearts and weighing on our minds this morning. So God, when we get back to our homes, get back to our jobs, get back to our families, God, we believe that you're already going to start working it out right now, God. We stand like the centurion that came to look for Jesus, and he says, look, Lord, by your word, my servant can be healed. By the time he got back to the house, the servant was healed. So God, we believe that God, on the way back home, on the way back to work tomorrow, God, by your grace and mercy, on the way back to the mailbox, God, our situation will be worked out. God, we lift up those members of our church that can't be here. God, look upon our deacons and deaconesses emeritus, God. God, look upon Reverend Herman Washington, Father, and continue to strengthen him, oh God. God, we pray that, God, we don't know what the issue is, but God, we know that you're able to heal it. So God, we pray that you would bless him and his congregation right now. Continue to hold him in the hollow of your hand. And God, we pray that, God, that you would bless this congregation. Bless all of us that make up this great body of Christ called the First Baptist Church of Bayshore. Unite us, oh God, together from heart to heart and breast to breast by the power of your shed blood. God, bless our pastor, oh God, as he continues to lead our congregation, God. Continue to bless him, oh God, and bless our leadership staff, oh God. And God, as you bless them, God, that you bless this whole entire congregation. That God, that we would continue to seek and see your goodness and your will and your mercy in the earth, God. That God, we will work together to build the kingdom and not tear down our congregation. That we will work together to build you up, oh God, and not tear someone else down. That God, we will work together to see your glory throughout all of Bayshore, Brentwood, and all throughout Islip and through Suffolk County, God. Because that's what you called us to do. So God, unite our hands to do the work. Unite our minds to see the task to be completed. That God, that you would get the glory and honor and the praise. And it's in the matchless name of Christ Jesus we pray. And all God's children say amen.
We will now have announcements.
Let the church say amen. Amen. Church say amen again. Amen. I just have a couple of announcements that I would like to share with you this morning. How many of you believe in the power of prayer? Amen. Well, I was expecting a little bit more than that. How many of y'all believe in the power of prayer? Yeah, yeah. There are a number of scriptures that tell us the significance of prayer, the effectual, fervent prayer, the righteous availeth much. Then 2 Chronicles 7:14 tells us what happens when God's people come together in prayer. This morning I stand to announce an initiative that is being put forth by our missionaries. It is a call to prayer, and it's simply pray on Wednesdays. Pow. Pray on Wednesdays, starting Wednesday, July 27th, and moving through September 28th, 2022. I see that our chair of our missionaries is here. Sister Green, thank you so much for sending this email, but also talking to us about it. And it moved me because I think it's important. Yeah, we have our Thursday night prayer. Amen. But this one, you don't have to come to the church. Matter of fact, you ain't got to put on no clothes and dress up. This is pray on Wednesday in your place, in your secret closet. Amen. From 12 noon on Wednesday morning and ending at 11:59 on Wednesday night. Now, if you can pray all that time, because the New Testament says pray without ceasing. Amen. But we're not asking you to do that because we know you got responsibilities, you got children to take care of, all that. We're just asking for 10 minutes, right? 10 minutes during that time period that you would carve out to pray. Now, there's some instructions, and these instructions are going to be listed on our website. We'll have them printed out and available for you on next Sunday. There are some topics that we want you to be specific in your prayers about. The Bible says, let your prayers be made known unto God. Be specific in your request unto God. The topics for prayers are the following. Suicide among children, especially African American youth from the ages of 10 to 35. Whether you realize it or not, it is a global pandemic as it relates to young people committing suicide. And so we want to pray for them. We want to pray for the areas of mental health. It is a real issue affecting our country, and whether we want to admit it or not, because of stigmas, we don't want to seek help. I know Sister Jillian is here, and others will agree with me that we want to stay away from psychologists and psychiatrists. Look, get some help, because you cannot struggle with these things by yourself. It will consume you and take you out of here. Amen. Real topic, suicide among children and mental health that is devastating our community. Secondly, the racial unrest and division in America. Amen. In our communities, not just black on black crime, but just crime in general that is going on because of the racial unrest in our country. Gun violence in our cities. And the recklessness of many of our youth with guns. I don't know if y'all saw the incident or heard the incident where they're going around now shooting people with these plastic bullets. And they think it's funny. But people are turning around with real guns and shooting back. Amen. We need to lift up our country and our community as it relates to gun violence. Sickness and disease. From the youngest as well as our senior citizens. I don't know if y'all heard, polio is back. Yes. First confirmed case of polio in the United States this past week. A young person. And they suggested that they were exposed to a person who got a polio vaccine in another country, and the vaccine that they got was the live disease. Hello, somebody. And so they're now starting to push for another polio vaccine. Not only that, we've got monkeypox. And now children are getting it. We need to pray, y'all. Whether it is the judgment of God, the reaction to ours, or just things that are happening, we need to pray for the health and healing of our country and our nation.
6, the need for spiritual revival and true awakening in the country and in the world. I like this comment, Sister Green, not this evangelical stuff. We need some real revival in the church. Some God-fearing revelations. Hello, somebody. Paul had an encounter with God. We need to have some authentic encounters with God, not this show stuff. I was looking at TV the other day, and I saw a commercial where Joel Osteen is coming to Yankee Stadium. And the tickets range from $16 to over $50. I thought the gospel was free. Billy Graham went all over this country and spoke everywhere, all over the world, and never charged a dime for people to hear the gospel. Hello, somebody. Hello, somebody. We need real, authentic revival. We need people to encounter God in a real way. But for that to happen, we got to be real. We need a spiritual revival. And lastly, prayer for homes and marriages in all stages, young, middle, and long term, that are ending because of death of one of their spouses. Each day needs God's guidance and grace to get them to the next stage. Amen. Our marriage, the institution of marriage, is under attack. It's been under attack for a while, but it's really on the surface now. You got to work to stay married today. Hello, somebody. You got to work to stay single, too. Hello, somebody. Because folk have motives. Deacon Jones, you and Sister Jones been married a while. Y'all happy? Some folk don't like the fact that you happily married. And they will come and try to disrupt your happy home just because they unhappy. Listen, just because your situation didn't work, don't try to put your situation on somebody else. Elder Bruce, we're praying for you. Amen. Hold on in there. These are 7 areas that our missionaries have deemed that we need to focus our attention on, and I agree with them, and I want you as a church body to come together and let's join them in this POW, prayer on Wednesday. Just take 10 minutes out of your day between 12 noon and 11:59 on Wednesday night, starting, is that next Wednesday or Wednesday after next week? This coming Wednesday, amen. I've given you the areas. If you can only remember one of them, then pray for that area for 10 minutes, and then you'll get the rest of the list next week. Amen. 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 Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise for our missionaries. Amen. Being the leaders and focusing us to the hills from which cometh all of our help. Also, on the second Sunday in August, your pastor will be participating in a pulpit exchange with the Christ Community Church of East Islip, thanks to Deacon Cornigans. Deacon Cornigans met Pastor James Lee probably a few years ago through his efforts with the Gideons. And then he was trying to get Pastor Lee and I together, and we just couldn't get together. And we found ourselves in a meeting together on Zoom. And he sent me a message. He says, "There is the infamous Pastor Clark. Please give me a call." And we got together, and there's just been a wonderful relationship between him and I over the last few months. We've joined together in a co-support group of the chaplaincy at South Shore Community Hospital. As a matter of fact, we are the co-chairs of the Spiritual Advisory Committee for the hospital. And we've talked about a number of things, and one of the things that we've talked about is the importance of multiracial communities coming together and celebrating our diversity. And so one of the suggestions that he had was an invitation for me to come and preach at Christ Community Church of East Islip. I'm gonna continue to say East Islip so some of y'all can get it. It's East I slip. Not west I slip, east I slip. Amen. Right before the entrance to the park, right there by the library, there's a beautiful church sitting right on the corner, Christ Community Church, on the second Sunday in August at 10:30. Your pastor will be the pastor of the day at Christ Community Church. Pastor James Lee is the pastor. If you cannot come and can't be a part of this service, can you pray for your pastor? Amen. Amen. Because Sister Reed, sometimes it's good to tell folk about themselves, but you got to do it in the right way. And I'm praying for guidance, but I learned a long time ago, if you lift up Jesus, it works everywhere all the time. Amen? Amen. Just want to let you know that. Also, y'all know that I celebrated a birthday a couple weeks ago, but we had some other folk in the church to celebrate birthdays in the month of July. And I don't know if we celebrated them, but I want to celebrate you. If you have or had a birthday in the month of July, or you got one coming, or an anniversary, or a special a day in your life that you celebrate every year, can you just stand up on your feet? If you can't stand, just wave your hand. Amen. 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 Congratulations to you, my brother, my sister, on the landmark day that God has blessed you to see. In reality, that when we wake up and we can see the top of the flowers as opposed to the bottom of the flowers, it is a good day. And a day to give God all the glory, all the honor, and all of the praise. We also want to thank you, for those of you who came out on yesterday, for our defensive driving class that was held on yesterday. I don't know if we're going to have another one before the end of the year. We've had two already. We will have another one. So if you missed out, please keep your eyes and ears open. We will be announcing another one. Amen. All right. Thank you. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise.
If all hearts and minds are clear, may we stand. Now, I apologize if it seems like I make it about me, but you know, when you stand up here, you forget the protocol. And, you know, you kind of get yourself out of order. You know, we go through this every week and you think that you know, but then when you're called upon, you have to blow the dust off it and try to remember what you say. I'm like, please don't let me be worship leader. Please don't let me be. I can't remember what the mission and vision statement is. You can get it started once it gets started. But anyway, I'm still trying to learn this thing. So pray for me. Amen. Here at First Baptist, we hold our tithe envelope in our right hand so that we can give God what is right and not what is left. Amen. I've already put mine in the box, so that's why I didn't have mine. I do that when I come in for Sunday school. Amen. Again, if all hearts and minds are clear, let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have blessed us with something to give for the upbuilding of your kingdom here on earth. Father, we pray that you would be pleased with our offering. We pray for those who have to offer, and we pray for those who do not. Nevertheless, Father, we pray that you would be a blessing to them so that they can contribute in some way. Amen. We love you and we thank you. Now, Father, we thank you for all that we have heard, all that we have experienced here on today. We pray that we would not keep this word to ourselves. Father, we're not going to let go until you bless us. And Father, even then, we may just loosen our grip just a bit, but we want to make sure that we walk closely with thee. Just a closer walk with thee, Father. We pray that we would not keep the word to ourselves, but you said in your word, go ye therefore. So, Father, we pray that we would tell this dying world that whosoever will hear us, Jesus saves. We know Christ Jesus. We love Christ Jesus. We try to do what is good and right in the sight of God. not what we think is right in our own eyes. We love you. We pray that we would go forth and be good stewards, that we would be good ambassadors, that we would represent you well. Now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times, in every way. The Lord be with you all. And let the church say, amen, amen, amen. Let the church say, amen. Let the church say, amen. God has spoken. Let the church say, let the church say amen. Let the church say amen. God has spoken. Let the church say amen. God be with you all. With sections A and C, follow the directions of the ushers, and then followed by that with section B. Amen.
Yes, ma'am. Why is it?